It's been 3.5 years since a young humpback whale died and washed ashore on Calvert Island off the coast of British Columbia. Since that spring day, a team of people have been working hard to learn all they can from this whale and restore his bones so his story can live on.
I love being able to have a project right from the very start with a whale that's, you know, passed away, lying on a beach somewhere, through the cleaning, and then the really fun part of like putting it all together, and then kind of like the climax of hanging it. And then when it's done and we stand back and look at the completed whale, that's just the best feeling ever.
Now that all the work is done, the young humpback's bones will make one last ocean voyage before coming to rest back on Calvert Island to end where his story started, on the last episode of Whale Bones. Moving thousands of kilometers along the coast and in deep ocean waters between their summer feeding and winter breeding grounds, humpback whales make some of the longest migrations of any animal on the planet. Though we don't know exactly how they navigate back and forth, it's possible that humpbacks use Earth's magnetic field as one way to orient themselves in the right direction. Humpbacks stagger their arrivals and departures, and the timing of these twice-yearly migrations isn't precise, but generally follows the seasons, and the journeys can take months to complete. Now that humpback whales along the British Columbia coast have begun to recover from industrial whaling, we have the privilege of reliably seeing humpbacks in the spring and summer, here in these rich, cold water feeding grounds. Because of that predictability, a whole new industry has built up around humpbacks: whale watching. Every year, millions of people around the world hop into boats hoping for a visit with whales in the wild. Commercial whale watching tourism brings in upwards of over $2 billion annually. Beyond being a boon for local economies, all those attentive eyes provide a ripe opportunity for learning more about humpbacks and other whales. Some companies support researchers by providing photos that help catalog individuals and reporting on the whale's movements, interactions, and other behaviors. And all of those whale-watching trips provide an opportunity for millions of people to be awed by nature, to have their curiosity in their hearts stoked, feeding deeper connections between whales and humans, and a greater sense of responsibility towards each other. But there's a growing concern that boats, the carbon they spew, the underwater noise they emit, and the potential for collisions they create, are causing added stress, potentially disrupting the whales' behavior and increasingly putting them in harm's way. Some countries like Canada have codified regulations into law to minimize the risk of colliding with or disturbing marine mammals. They include distance and speed requirements and avoiding all forms of harassment or interference. These laws also help protect humans, who can be severely injured in collisions with large, unpredictable whales like humpbacks. An alternative to watching whales from boats, whale trails and other land-based spots for whale watching have grown in popularity as humpback numbers have rebounded here in British Columbia, increasing the odds of seeing whales from land. And all that's needed is a sturdy set of shoes and a pair of binoculars. Crated and traveling above the waterline, the Calvert Island whale looks nothing like his former self. But hidden in that huge crate are the bones that have spent the last 3.5 years revealing their secrets, telling the tales of the short life this young whale lived, the dangers he faced and survived, and the one that he didn't. Now, it's time for those stories to be shared with the wider world. After a busy summer season full of scientists, school groups, boaters, and other visitors to the Hakai Institute's Ecological Observatory and the surrounding beaches and trails on Calvert Island, the crowds have gone, and the main lodge has grown quiet. It's here, high above the tables where visitors come together to share meals, scientific discoveries, and stories of their adventures, that Mike and his team will hang the Calvert whale.
Typically now, people will see whales in the wild and they'll be off in the distance. We're not supposed to get very close to them because we don't want to disturb them.
and you know, they're the incredible animals, but what we see is just a tiny little snippet of their life as they come to the surface for a breath. And so when you get to stand next to these skeletons and realize like how big these animals are, like it just takes your breath away, first of all. And then you also realize that these are like animals like us. And you realize that they're all individuals that call our oceans home. Today, they're not extinct dinosaurs. They're out there.
They're out there, and they have more in common with us than you might think. Like us humans and a select few other big-brained animals, such as the great apes, elephants, killer whales, and other dolphin species, humpbacks have specialized brain cells, a type of spindle cell, that are thought to be involved in things like intuition and our ability to feel love, trust, empathy, and emotional suffering. The cell's presence in humpback brains hints at the possibility that these whales are also capable of complex social interactions and intelligence. It's just one more humpback mystery waiting to be solved. Mike and many others have pulled the pieces of this whale apart in order to rebuild him. And along the way, they've teased apart small mysteries of not just how the whale died, but how he lived.
Working really closely with the bones is really an intimate experience.
Every skeleton I've done has been so individual. Like, this is the third humpback skeleton we put together. It's the smallest, and this little guy, like, yeah, it was really sad seeing him on the beach because he was so young and his skull just fell apart into a whole bunch of pieces. It really looked like he'd been hit by a ship. It was, you know, it's a sad ending to his life and then beginning of this process of, you know, salvaging his bones. We had all these chunks, and then we got his skull together, and then it, you know, you actually could then look him in the eye and like you feel some connection and you feel, you know, a little bit moved by this individual that, you know, lived and swam around in these oceans here. And I feel really good about putting them all back together and getting him on display so that he can, you know, in some way like speak to people and, you know, carry a message of like the awesomeness that we have out in our oceans. Yeah. And also make people aware of like the dangers. I'm really grateful to be able to be a part of doing something with a, you know, this tragic circumstance.
There's just so much that we can learn from them. They're like nature's art. They're like these perfect sculptures that have a function. I never planned on doing this as a career. It just sort of like all the pieces fell together. And you know, every day when I wake up, I feel so lucky to be able to walk into my workshop full of like whale bones, and they're like giant jigsaw puzzles, and I get to figure out how to put them together. It's just like, I couldn't imagine a better job. I don't think this is ever gonna get old for me. I really hope that I can keep doing it, you know, until I can't anymore.
Thanks to Mike and the long, hard work of so many others, the Calvert humpback's death has deepened our understanding of humpback whales, especially those here off the coast of British Columbia. And diving and rolling over the heads of all visitors to come, this humpback will serve as a warning call, reminding us what can happen when the balance between humans and nature ends in a life cut short. He will continue to share his stories, to awe us in his grandeur and grace, to remind us of how lucky we are to have a second chance with these giants, and with luck, to stoke a passion for protecting these magnificent whales and the ocean they call home.